Thank you, Professor Ram. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be associated with this event here. I'm more delighted that all of you are also interested in a bit of archaeology, which is known as a subject of explorer, but not a subject of science. But I would like to convince you through my lecture that is more science than being an adventure activity. When I was invited to talk, I thought it is more appropriate to talk on the Vindhya Basin, not because the event is taking place in Bhopal, but because of the fact that Vindhya has provided excellent body of evidence to be able to reconstruct the way in which human bicultural evolution has occurred through time in the Indian subcontinent. Because this is one of the distinctive geographical areas in India which has been subject to detailed multidisciplinary archaeological studies. So as a result, we have now reached a position in terms of finding a place for Indian subcontinent in global synthesis of prehistory. The term prehistory implies an integrated study of archaeology, quaternary science, and paleoanthropology, so that we can understand the biocultural evolution of human society across the world, living in distinctive geographical environments, and so that we get a clear idea of when and where human origins, cultural origins, and expansion of settlements occurred, and the processes behind the expansions that have governed the peopling of the world can be reconstructed with the kind of systematic study of all these components of data coming from archaeology, quaternary science, as well as paleoanthropology. Paleoanthropology, as we all know, specifically deals with human fossil remains. Quaternary science helps us understand the context, the geological context, the climatological context, environmental context in which the archaeological evidence is preserved. And then archaeology as such will help us to identify presence or absence of human activity at a given point of time, at a given place, and so on and so forth. So with this background, I would like to emphasize why Vindhya's have played a very important role in reconstruction of prehistory of the Indian subcontinent. As you can see here, Europe, Africa, and Asia, they are three contiguous continents, and they constitute what we call in archaeological parlance or in prehistory the old world, because these are the continents where we have the oldest evidence of human settlements. Amongst the three continents, what we have, Africa at the center of our understanding of human origins and cultural origins and so on. It is where it is East Africa or Eastern and Southern Africa can be together considered as cradle of mankind. And we have the oldest evidence of both human ancestral fossil remains as well as cultural remains coming through time in the form of stone tools and associated artifacts. And these two combined have helped us understand how human evolution and cultural evolution took place in Africa. And the earliest evidence that we have here in East Africa, who was capable of expanding out of Africa, is identified as Homo erectus. We have pre-erectus human ancestors here called Homo habilis. They were largely confined to Africa. But the first person who moved out of Africa is Homo erectus, and is also credited with the invention of this particular technology, what we call lower Paleolithic Acheulean technology. We have two distinctive type of stone tools, which is a hand axe here, and then a cleaver. These are diagnostic of this particular technocomplex Acheulean, and Homo erectus gradually evolved, or in simple terms I say this, gradually gave rise to what we call Homo heidelbergensis. So Homo erectus and Homo heidelbergensis are found outside of Africa as well. So there are suggestions that it was not out of Africa 1, which is largely associated with Homo erectus, it is out of Africa 2, should also be referring to Homo heidelbergensis expanding out of Africa. But out of Africa 2 normally now refers to what we call expansion of modern humans or Homo sapiens out of Africa. But anyway, we have both Homo erectus and Homo heidelbergensis being older in Africa than in other parts of the old world. So we have Homo erectus expanding out of Africa into Europe and into Asia, and then Homo heidelbergensis sites are known from some parts of India as well, but we are not as yet sure. One of the human ancestral fossils which was found several decades ago, he is now being debated whether it is Homo erectus or archaic Homo sapiens, or it was whether Homo heidelbergensis and so on, but finally people have come to a conclusion that it is Homo indeterminate. Anyway, so Homo heidelbergensis gradually gave rise to two distinctive human ancestral species. One is Homo neanderthalensis, largely found in Africa and more dominantly found in Europe, and then Homo sapiens. So this is the time scale in which we are dealing with this human evolution. These are the reconstructions based on the study of cranial fossils belonging to these Homo erectus, Homo heidelbergensis, Homo neanderthalensis and modern man. So this modern man in Africa goes back to nearly 200,000 years ago. So he's our immediate ancestor. So they are associated with the stone tool technology, Homo erectus, Homo heidelbergensis with Acheulean technology. And Homo neanderthalensis with what we call Middle Paleolithic, Mousterian, and then Levalva technology that we get to see in the context of the sites associated with Homo neanderthalensis and early Homo sapiens sites in Africa. And then what we have here with Homo sapiens, we have distinctive Upper Paleolithic associated with microlithic, early invention of microlithic technology. Even that has been found to be the oldest in Africa, going back to about 60,000 years ago. For a very, very long time, microlithic technology was thought to be of Holocene in time, that is only during the last 10,000 years. But we have excellent context in Africa and elsewhere in Europe as well as even in India that microlithic technology goes back to late Pleistocene and so on. So this, the example of what we call evolved Levalva technology, where there was development in technology where the emphasis was on producing smaller flakes and modify them into various types of stone tools called scrapers, borers, notches, points and so on and so forth. And further upwards in time, we see microliths, composite tools coming into use, and large game hunting becoming common now, you know, subsistence way, subsistence mode of these communities and so on. So India is a large subcontinent, a continental scale landmass separated from Northern Asia by these Himalayan Burma mountains and this, you know, Balochistan mountain ranges and this Indian Ocean in the south. Yet it is connected by land with Southwest Asia, Northern Africa, and then of course Europe and so on. As a result of these continuous land connections, expansion of human populations from one region to another region was possible during favorable times and through those dispersal paths where they had suitable availability of suitable raw materials and so on. So we would like to understand from the archaeological record we have documented from different parts of India when exactly the Homo erectus expansion into the Indian subcontinent occurred. Once it happened, how and when the later processes were responsible for expansion within the Indian subcontinent and so on. And once they were into the distinctive environmental geographical areas in the subcontinent, how they were capable of adapting to local conditions and so on, and how cultural evolution has continued, and what the later expansion events and cultural developments, technological developments transformed the archaeological record, reflecting upon changes in the behavioral aspects of the early hunter-gatherer communities across the Indian subcontinent. So by about the Acheulean expansion, Homo erect expansion associated with Acheulean technology reached India, and beyond this point, although we see Homo erectus beyond northeastern India into East Asia and Southeast Asia and so on, This Acheulean technology is restricted to this particular region, whereas the Homo erectus associated that we find in other parts of Eastern Asia, their stone tool technology was very, very different from what we see in these three areas, Europe, Africa and India. So it is the type of tool what we call cleavers, large flake cleavers, and then this cleaver and hand axe technology gradually evolves from early Acheulean to middle Acheulean to late Acheulean and so on. And that is also reflected in the way in which raw material was put to use and how minimum effort was employed to modify a piece of stone into a suitable artifact like cleaver and hand axe and so on. So we see successive developmental stages, but unfortunately in the Indian subcontinent we have not been able to see this in stratigraphical context, that early Acheulean, middle Acheulean and late Acheulean, which is very well documented in African and European sites. So as a result, when technological comparisons, detailed technological analysis of various assemblages from distinctive areas in Europe, in Africa and in India, they are suggestive of the fact that during the later Acheulean, human expansion into the Indian subcontinent might have occurred. But that may be one way of assessing the chronological position of the earliest human settlements in the Indian subcontinent. But now we have excellent dating methods available. So until recently we didn't have them, and we are now in a very healthy situation that we can specifically figure out when exactly the settlement came into existence and in which part of the Indian subcontinent we have older sites and younger sites and so on and so forth. So Acheulean technology did not go beyond Asia, and this particular division is also known among archaeologists as the Movius line. Similarly, we also have another problem here. Although this map shows this scratch has all through southern India, but we have a Kaveri line here. South of the Kaveri, we have not so far been successful in documenting presence of this kind of stone tool other places. So as a result, we have two distinctive lines of separation of Acheulean cultural zone in the Indian subcontinent. One is the northeast India and then the Kaveri line, south of Kaveri line into Sri Lanka. We have so far not found any evidence of earliest human settlements. As a result of that, by our archaeological experience, we are now able to include Sri Lanka as part of the New World. New World is associated with expansion of modern humans, recent colonization by modern human populations, which may be in the time range of about 30 to 40,000 years ago, and as recently as 36,000 years ago into Latin America and so on. We have an excellent body of dating evidence, datable evidence coming from large number of sites. There were suggestions earlier in the 1980s that we have very old lower Paleolithic occupations. They could not be called Acheulean, they could not be called older one, but yet there were some indications of presence of humans as early as 2.2 to 1.8 million years ago. But they remained in isolation for a very, very long time. But by the end of 20th century, new methodologies, new sites, reinvestigations at a number of sites, they were quite encouraging. And as a result of that, two sites in southern India, one is Isampur in northern Karnataka and Athirampakkam in southeast coast of India. Isampur is situated in the Bhima Basin, which is one of the Proterozoic Precambrian Basin in India. And Athirampakkam is also a site associated with Upper Gondwana formations in that region. South of this particular river, we do not have any evidence of earliest settlements going back to the time that we have from these two sites. And very recently, in the last 5 years, a site called Tikoda, about 60 kilometers north of northeast of Bhopal, is being investigated by archaeologists. And there are suggestions that this site is also going back to the lower Pleistocene. And the problem of identifying sites in the lower Pleistocene context was very, very difficult because our quaternary sequences along the major rivers in India do not go beyond middle Pleistocene. So as a result, we were to depend on context which could take us backwards in time as far as possible, and then say equate the antiquity with those sites in Africa. Although we know that expansion took place out of Africa, there must be some time gap between African sites and the Indian sites as well. But the lower Pleistocene context was to be identified. As a result, the sites away from alluvial context were to be investigated. Tikoda is one such site. Isampur is another site, as well as Athirampakkam. So they are all buried stratified sites, and they have applied new dating methods. As a result of that, we now know that this site, which was discovered in the 1860s, was reinvestigated during the last 25 years, and now we know that this site is at least 1.5 million years old. And then we have this Isampur dated to 1.2 million years, but this was an isolated date for a long time. The community, scientific community, was not able to have any kind of confidence in that date, and so they decided that we wait for some time and run more samples and then see if we have the same number coming again. So once the date for this site was established, there was some encouragement, and then this 1.2 million year old ESR date was also getting recognized. Thikoda has now a very excellent sequence. We have dates. Unfortunately, they are not yet published. I know personally from the investigators that they also have paleobacteric dates as well as absolute dates, similar to the ones applied at Athirampakkam, and they seem to be, this site seems to be even older than 1.5 million years or so. So these three sites have transformed our understanding of the earlier settlements in the Indian subcontinent. So the site of Athirampakkam is also known for this kind of tools. This site was also discovered in the 1860s, and then subject to reinvestigation periodically, but the most scientific and multidisciplinary investigations were carried out by Dr. Shanti Pappu in the last 20 years or so. As a result, this particular deposit, which is a fissured clay deposit, 3 to 5 meters in thickness, has got this buried, lower Paleolithic context, an activity could be reconstructed based on the distribution of types of stone artifacts in a given area and so on. Formerly, this particular deposit was considered a Cretaceous clay, but then the investigations here threw light in such a way that the geologists had a shock of their life, and then it came to be lower Pleistocene clay deposit associated with some kind of local fluvial environment. So these are the distinctive tool types, hand axes, cleavers and choppers and so on, made from quartzite. So the most ideal rock that was suitable for making this kind of stone tools, abundant in the Gondwana formations. So they are associated with the Satyavedu formation of the upper Gondwanas, and the sites are associated with that particular formation along the southeast coast, pediment surfaces and so on. So this is the clay, and then in which this particular stone artifact is embedded. So this site has given us great hope that we may have many sites in the Vindhyas in particular, because the density of sites of that type are much more in the Vindhyan basin than elsewhere. And this is another site, region called the Bhima Basin. This is part of the Bhima Basin known as Hunsigi Valley. It's a 500 square kilometer oval shaped limestone plateaus, and then we have these within this plateau large number of springs, perennial springs feeding the smaller streams here, and then it's all perennial. Even at the height of summers, you have this greenery around in this valley. So it was not difficult to understand why this area was a suitable habitat for even during the Paleolithic times. So Dr. Padaya, who surveyed this area, found nearly 200 Acheulean localities in an area of 500 square kilometers, the densest occurrence anywhere in that particular region, northern Karnataka. Bhima Basin is also one smaller, the smallest Proterozoic basin or Prorana basin that we know. And then these are these two small streams, this is the Hunsigi and the Baichwal. They join together and finally go into the Krishna River here. But the sites are distributed only in this region, and as we move away from here, we hardly come across any Acheulean locality. So they are associated with these limestone outcrops, and limestone was of the useless raw material for making stone tools, yet they made use of it for various reasons, because the habitability of the area was more under consideration. Now this is another site in the same region where the ESR date for 1.2 million years age was obtained for this particular site called Isampur Quarry. This is the oldest known Paleolithic stone quarry anywhere in the world, not even in Africa. Now, if the date continues to be, strengthened as the lower Pleistocene, and we may have the oldest lower Paleolithic quarry anywhere in the world. And so this site has yielded nearly 15,000 artifacts in a very small, trench of about 15 by 20, length and breadth. And here we have the complete processing sequence documented from the excavated surface. We have this evidence of quarrying of blocks of limestone. Now, you stone hammer blow was given here, and then there are fractured blocks of limestone could be detached from there, and subsequent to that, pyramidal flakes, large flakes were struck off from this sides, pyramidal flakes were removed, and then these large flakes were modified into hand axes and cleavers and so on. We can reconstruct and what we call refitting the waste products lying in the spot. And then if we can reassemble them, we arrive at this particular block of limestone. Limestone is generally very, very soft raw material, but then there is a particular variety of limestone in this region which is siliceous. Higher silica content has enabled this limestone harder than the rest of the varieties of limestone here. As a result, this densest occurrence of limestone Paleolithic sites are found in Hunsky Valley. As I mentioned about Tikoda, which is about is in the Vindhya Basin, being investigated even now, has got extensive scatter of stone artifacts. Every stone piece that you see here is an artifact. And we have surface mapping of all the scatter of artifacts as we do today is being gridded and mapped. And then subsurface occurrence of artifacts were also documented. So this is the context in which we would like to be working in with a great deal of interest, because it provides us opportunities for multidisciplinary investigations. So excavations like they were conducted at Athirampakkam and Hunsigi are also being conducted here, and systematic sampling of various strata and then the micro remains as well as chemical analysis of the sediments is being carried out. Paleomag analysis is also being done, and that has helped us to think in terms of a lower Pleistocene context for this particular site as well. If Tikoda is lower Pleistocene, I am sure any other site which is of this made up, composed of this kind of artifacts and landscape will be equally old, and then they are likely to be older than the sites that we have in southern India. 50,000 years, 100,000 years, 200,000 years difference between the sites in the Vindhyas and in the southern Indian basins also matters for us in order to be able to reconstruct the dispersal patterns associated with movement of Homo erectus into the Indian subcontinent. So the old world context, we have these sites, well-known sites. These were known much earlier, but these dates are based on geological stratigraphy and paleomag alone, but no direct dating of the context in which the artifacts have been recovered. But then we have the sites like Isampur, Tikoda and Athirampakkam giving us greater hope that we have better chronological control on the earliest settlements in the Indian subcontinent. So the expansion is northerly expansion out of Africa. And we have, as because of this, we suspect that the sites as we come from northwest into the central India and further south, the sites seems to be younger here and older here, and then we can certainly reconstruct the dispersal path of the Homo erectus into the Indian subcontinent and beyond. Whether they cut across eastern India into East Asia and Southeast Asia is yet to be conclusively determined, because there are some areas in the Indian subcontinent which are devoid of evidence of early Acheulean localities. So the seven basins that we have, Proterozoic basins that we have in the Indian subcontinent, Aravallis, Vindhyas, Chhattisgarh, Pranhita, Godavari, Kadapa, Kaladgi, Bhima basins, we consider these are the regions where we have the densest occurrence of these early Paleolithic sites. And when it comes to the areas like Deccan Volcanic province, we have very sparse distribution of early Paleolithic sites, and we enter this granitic terrain, Precambrian terrain, this granite and Charnokite terrain here, we have hardly any lower Paleolithic site. So as a result, there is a differential distribution of all these earliest settlements that we have. And these are some of the sites, in the Vindhya region, in Kadapa and, northern Karnataka, Bhima and Kaladgi basins here. So this particular distribution is observable and also can be quantified in terms of number of sites belonging to this particular time period, that there is a preference for certain geological basins. So as a result of that, we have been able to develop a basin model which explains why the settlements are densely situated in these basins and why they are sparsely situated in some relatively Deccan basalt regions, hardly any site in the Ganga basin or Indus basin and so on, and the sub-Himalayas, occasionally there are some sites, and then in the region of granitic region, we hardly have, there are no sites at all. So that is why we are thinking in terms of concentrating our efforts in these areas to be able to be more productive and then contribute more towards understanding the peopling of the globe during the out of Africa 1 and out of Africa 2 phases. So Middle Paleolithic is the time period which succeeds the early Paleolithic or the Acheulean time period. It is associated with the production of stone artifacts on flakes, and the technology is very different. We have what is called Mousterian technology and Levallois technology, well-developed Levallois technology associated with the early modern humans in Africa, and gradually expanding outside, out of Africa into other parts of the old world and then into the new world as well. Now these sites in India are usually along the lower Paleolithic sites. Wherever we have lower Paleolithic context, we also have middle Paleolithic context, but there is a temporal separation between the two, because from the alluvial strata we are able to identify some kind of time gap between the two formations. Characterized by centripetal core reduction, that is technology aspect of it, and prepared core discoidal Levallois reduction technology was very, very dominant here, and flakes usually thinner and smaller than those used during the earlier period, and shift from quartzite to high quality siliceous material like chert, agate, jasper, chalcedony, and so on and so forth, and these are called high quality and they are more useful for producing durable artifacts. And then the sites are abundant, they are abundantly rich in variety of scraper types, and the widespread distribution of the middle Paleolithic we see not only in those areas where we have Acheulean settlements, but also outside new areas were also colonized by these middle Paleolithic communities. Now this is generally associated with the expansion out of Africa, and the first Homo idaltu is dated to about 1,96,000 years ago. Then subsequently what we have is the emergence of microlithic technology in East Africa around 60,000 years ago. These are the suggestions based on Western models that we are familiar with. They are not models based on the evidence from Asia and Eastern Asia and Australia and so on. So this model, which is being now very popular amongst archaeologists and prehistorians, they suggest two modes of dispersal associated with expansion of modern humans out of Africa. And the one is associated with the southern dispersal, and another one is associated with the northern dispersal. This one is generally accompanied by what we call microlithic technology, and this we are now suggesting, based on some evidence in India and in Arabia, that this is not only 60,000 years ago, but even earlier than 60,000 years ago. Now this is the type of Levallois technology, that the core is prepared and the flake is detached. So you have a predetermined size of the flake, thickness of the flake, and a core is prepared in such a way that the flake comes off in terms of what you desire to produce. And these are some of the examples of Homo sapiens skulls from Africa and Levant and so on. And then we have these dates based on DNA analysis, coalescence dates suggesting about 50,000 years ago, modern humans expanded into the Indian subcontinent. But then archaeology has something else to say, and that we are trying to emphasize more on the kind of evidence that we have in the Indian context, as well as the dates that we have from the sites we have dated. Now this is the example of various types of scrapers made from high quality raw material like chert, jasper, chalcedony, and so on and so forth. We have scrapers, points, borers, and so these are distinctive types of stone artifacts associated with modern human settlements in the Indian subcontinent, also called Middle Paleolithic. And of course, we do have further development in technology associated with the first production of microliths. very diminutive flakes detached from pyramidal fluted cores, prismatic cores, and then they are very slender and they were used as composite tools and so on. So this technology was considered Mesolithic for a very, very long time. But we know from Africa and elsewhere, and also from Indian context, that Upper Paleolithic is not simply characterized by the production of long parallel sided elongated blades, but also now microliths. And many of those rock shelter sites which were excavated in the last century have been identified as Mesolithic sites. Now if we go back and look at them, the context, and then apply modern dating techniques, we are sure many of the rock shelters which have been assigned Mesolithic status will go back to later Pleistocene, Upper Paleolithic and so on. These are some of the hopes that we have. Coming to the Vindhya Basin, we have this very well defined largest Purana Basin that we have. It is about 1,60,000 square kilometer area, of which only 60,000 square kilometer is exposed. Rest of it is covered by the younger cover or the Deccan volcanic province. So the southwestern part is covered by this Deccan volcanic province, and we have the remaining area represented by various formations and groups, Vindhyan supergroup of rocks, the Kaimur and then Pachamari. Then for the south we have Satpuras and so on, which are separating Vindhyas from peninsular South India. Now we have this Ganga plains here, and then the Aravallis, and east westwards of the Aravallis we have the Great Indian Deserts and so on. But this particular region is drained by a large number of rivers, Narmada being one, Son and Belan in northeastern part here, and then we have Chambal, Betwa and several other tributary rivers like Tones and so on. All these rivers were the focus of attention of prehistorians. But now, given the experience that we have from sites in the Hunsky Valley, in Nathirampakkam and in Tikwada area, and prior to that in the 70s, Professor Jerem Jacobson also established the fact the Paleolithic settlements are not to be found only along the river valleys, but they can be found away from the river valleys. So he surveyed the Raisen district here, and then he found that in a rocky surface expanse of Vindhyan outcrops, he found hundreds of sites scattered. Nearly 750 sites were discovered in an area of 100,000 square kilometers. He could not find an explanation. Why do we have sites away from the water courses? Now, the explanation we have now is, given the time period when these settlements were taking place, the water tables, groundwater tables were much higher than what we see today. As a result of high water tables, there was a large number of springs functioning in the entire Vindhya Basin. The topography facilitated formation of perennial spring activity. So the communities were not required to go in search of channeled water courses. So they were very closely associated with these springs, and the extinct spring activity can also be documented if one can go very carefully and see for look for what we call spring tufa deposits. So with the receding water table in the fissures and cracks in the quartzites and sandstones and so on, one can certainly document the presence of spring tufa. This we have seen in southern Indian context. So we are sure this was also the case here. So inland sites are much more better preserved than those sites which are in the context of rivers and so on. So, and this is another reason which has also been focus of research by paleontologists, paleoanthropologists, and also quaternary geologists. Quaternary geological survey has conducted extensive documentation of the fluvial sediments in this year, and they have identified formations in terms. This is from. For the next river. There are formations like Pilikarar, Dhansi, Surajkund, Baneta, Hardipur, Bausara and Ramnagar. So this sequence of formations have been documented, and in each of these formation deposit, we have archaeological material. And also in this particular formation, we have the youngest toe buttuff. So the discovery of Angus Toba Tuff in this area was first made in the 1980s by Martin Williams and Clark, and unfortunately it was not taken up very seriously. But the rediscovery of the same volcanic ash in the 1980s gave rise to a renewed interest in establishing the quaternary chronology and the formation, succession and so on and so forth. And this sites, the Narmada Valley is also well known for the earliest discovery of a lower Paleolithic site in the 1860s, 150 years ago. And then we have the site of Hathnora, which is very famous for the only evidence of human cranial fossil and some associated fragments of clavicle coming from the site area. And then we have some of these sites are volcanic ash sites, and they have also helped us in reconstructing the context in which Paleolithic material and can the dating of that particular material has been made possible. And the Son Valley, that's where we have much more intense research activity having taken place since the 1980s. We have this again, documentation for lower Pleistocene sequence. And the material, archaeological material, has been documented from Middle and Upper Pleistocene context. So as a result, we are not very sure whether we have Lower Pleistocene Acheulean context here or not. But it is possible that, somewhere we have this missing link preserved, and then if that can be located and documented, we will have a quaternary sequence going from Lower Pleistocene onwards. So this bedrock is certainly lower Proterozoic variety of metasediments like sandstone, quartzite and limestone and so on and so forth. So, large number of sites are known. And these are some of the sites where intensive documentation of archaeological material has been carried out, and the dating of the sequence is also made possible because of the presence of the youngest tuff and detailed quaternary study of quaternary formations has helped us in identifying those five formations here. And these are the sites where we have found very clear evidence of evolution from Middle to Upper Paleolithic and later periods. So the oldest Lower Paleolithic goes back to 132,000 years. So we are suggesting here that we may have this long time span for the Lower Paleolithic in the Indian subcontinent, going from 1.5 million years to 132,000 years, almost 1 million years of settlement history for the Lower Paleolithic in the Indian subcontinent. And the most important find that we have in Narmada Valley is this particular cranium, now dated to 236 to 160,000 years ago. We are not very sure. The context has been modified a great deal by later investigators and so on. And we were able to rediscover the presence of a human skull going back to the later Pleistocene in the collections, in the personal collections of late V.S. Wakankar. And that is being now subject to detailed study. And in addition to that, Anthropological Survey of India also reported these fragments from Hathnora. Now we have some hope of extracting ancient DNA from these particular specimens. We have requested experts to help us to understand the nature of human population associated with the early settlements here. There's a famous site of Vimbetka, and the rock shelter 3 of 23 was excavated in the 1970s by V and Mishra. And then the neighboring rock shelters were also subject to excavation by V.S. Wakankar, Susan Haas and so on. One of those rock shelters yielded the human skull, which I showed you in the previous slide. But this particular rock shelter floor excavation became a textbook example and the best example to understand how Acheulean, or the earliest Homo erectus stone tool technology, continuously evolved through time from lower to middle to upper and Mesolithic and so on. There is a continuity of archaeological evidence, but does not imply that there is a transition from one phase to another phase through technology. Initially, this particular sequence was used for generating a model called technological continuity model. But now there is a new model which is replacement, technological replacement model, in order to argue for expansion and expansion of Homo sapiens into the Indian subcontinent, replacing Homo erectus and so on. So this is the landscape associated with the Vindhyas here. These outcrops have rock shelters. And these pediments have also human occupation, and excavations at various spots also have given us very clear evidence of lithic assemblages coming from different strata and so on. So this is one such rock shelter which has very clear visible. Can you see them? These are red paintings suspected to be Mesolithic in age, because the cave floor, the rock shelter floor, as a scatter of artifacts was generally microliths of the Mesolithic period. But then some of the excavations have given us a clue to the fact that these microliths go back in time, and this was the kind of prismatic core, fluted core, when long slender microlithic blades were detached, and such some of these have been found in this low energy sediments, not more or less primary context, not removed from the original place of discard and so on. So these rock shelters are rich in rock paintings, and rock paintings tell us more about the people, their life ways, their knowledge of the environment, their association with the animal world, and some of these paintings are very narrative in character. And this is the cave known as auditorium cave in Bimbetka, and rich in all in no part of the surface is left without a painting. So we have variety of animals, human forms, hunting scenes, and these are called pictographs. And then we have petroglyphs. Now these have also been considered as rock art by rock art specialists. And then there's now looking at this particular feature as cupules and cup marks and so on and so forth, and they are now considered to go back in time to lower Paleolithic and so on. So other examples of rock art here. In fact, the rock art that we have in the Indias was discovered long before the European rock art sites were discovered. It was Carlyle, A.C.L. Carlyle, who was surveying the Mirzapur district of north central India, which is now part of Uttar Pradesh. The Kaimur Hill Ranges, there is a place called Morana Pahar, this particular panel of rock art. And he in fact suggested as early as 1860s that we may have Upper Paleolithic rock art in India. But later researchers could not support the idea, and then they always associated this rock art with the Mesolithic hunter-gatherers occupying the Vindhyas in this area. So these are cup marks or cupules. They are found not only at Bimbetka but elsewhere in this Vindhya region, and one place called Daraki Chattan has yielded these, and now they say that rock, some of these petroglyphs at Bimbetka and Daraki Chattan can be the oldest rock art in the Indian subcontinent. Now another interesting thing that we discovered, that was discovered in the Vindhya Basin, was in the Belan Valley at a site called Bhagor, the excavators were encountered by this particular stone circle. And then it's not only a circle of stone rubble, but there were some very interesting stone pieces with patterns like this, triangular patterns. So this particular symbol is also seen in the paintings there. There's a continuity. Now this is from an Upper Paleolithic context, late Pleistocene context, and then there is a survival of this particular stone with this particular pattern being worshipped by the local community, local tribal communities. So this is called Angari Devi. So it's a mother goddess cult prevailing in this area, associated with the ethnographic community, and also now found in archaeological context. So this extends backwards in time to as early as Upper Pleistocene, and so the mother goddess these two are examples, living traditions, and this particular one is from the excavation at the site called Bhagor in the Belan Valley. So there is a continuity. So we have this particular shrine associated with Upper Paleolithic human activity in this area. Now I was talking about this youngest Toba tuff, which has now been found in the initial stages when it was first reported. It was in a very secondary context, but later resurvey and fresh search for youngest Toba tuff since the 1980s has given rise to identifying thick beds of volcanic ash occurring in the alluvial sequences in this river. This is dated to 74,000 years ago. It has its origin in Sumatra. its eruption took place 74,000 is associated with the super volcanic eruption known to have caused volcanic winter and has led to cataclysmic activity on life of organic life and so on and so forth. So that has now been documented from a large number of river valleys across central and southern India. So in the 1980s, I was involved in the rediscovery of this particular formation in an unexpected area. This is a rhyolitic tuff which was discovered near Pune at a site called Bori in the Kukdi River Valley, where it is a Deccan volcanic province. So that was a misfit in that particular context. But then we were very sure that this is field characteristics were very clear to us that this is a volcanic ash material, and subsequent laboratory examination and then dating and all that, we have conclusively arrived at the fact that this is angiostoba tuff, because geochemical fingerprinting has been done, argon-argon dating has been done, fission track dating has been done and so on, and single crystal argon dating has also been done. All of them converge to suggest that this has its source in the Toba eruption of 74,000 years ago. So its presence in the alluvial sequence has helped us in identifying the cultural material below and above, or before and after the ash fall. And that has implications for understanding human adaptations to the environment, dramatic changes that occurred after the ash fall and the environment prior to the ash fall and so on and so forth. So whether that affected continuity of population or not, and to what extent humans were capable of readapting to a changed environment and so on. So this became the focus of our study. So as a result of this, the Jureri Valley has also given us excellent geological context of this particular volcanic ash and the archaeological material below and above. Similarly, the Son Valley. So these two areas have provided us enough food for thought to be able to generate behavioral models for Indian prehistoric developments. So this particular site called Jwalapuram in the Karnool Basin has the thickest volcanic ash deposit preserved anywhere in India. That's not very important for us. This is certainly 74,000 years ago. Below that, we have this particular horizon. Like at Athirampakkam, a Acheulean site, we have this Middle Paleolithic site preserved below the volcanic ash. And then the industry that we see here continues even after the ash fall here. Now this is the kind of landscape that we have. This is a large number of rock shelters here with paintings and so on is near in an area of 2000 acres, we have 200 rock shelters, and all of them have paintings of the time period. Now we are very sure that these paintings also go back to later Pleistocene and so on. Now this particular evidence gave us a lot of encouragement to look at the context elsewhere. We went back to the sites which were previously known to us, and then we were able to document them and tie them up and so on and so forth. So as a result, we now have a very clear evidence of Middle Paleolithic culture, the Indian subcontinent, which can be associated with the early expansion of modern humans into the Indian subcontinent, is at least 80,000 years ago. So it is possible that first expansion of modern humans out of Africa must have occurred around 120,000 years ago. There are some clues from Arabia, but there is an argument going on. The debate continues to be there, no doubt about it. But then we have this ash covering a vast area from Southeast Asia, the Sumatra, towards the Arabian Sea up to East Africa and so on. So there are large number of sites, they have been tied up to establish chronology of sedimentary sequence as well as the archaeological material contained in the sedimentary sequence and so on. So Toba is here, and then we have all these sites coming from Arabian Sea and then the Indian subcontinent, and the dating of all these ash sites has also been carried out by geochronologists across the world. So we have these sites in the Son Valley south of the Kaimur Ranges, which have been subject to detailed study. This is the Son Valley sequence, ash sites as well as Paleolithic sites. And so chronology is very, very clearly established. The site of Dhaba, we have evidence of a quarry again, not comparable to the one I showed in the context of Isampur in South India, but this is a quarry associated with an outcrop of quartzite here. And then we have this continuous sequence of stone artifacts evolving from late Acheulean to Middle Paleolithic and Upper Paleolithic and so on. So these are some of the localities which were excavated, and then the quaternary sequence was also systematically documented. So sampling for dating, and then sampling for detailed thermos biocell dating, and sampling for sedimentology have been gathered from all these sites, and the archaeological material has also been fixed properly in the sequence, and then the thickness of the sequence, and outside the sub-Himalayan regions, quaternary sequences are not thicker than are not as thicker than as we see in the Son and Narmada valleys. As we go further southwards, we are entering into your rocky basins, and then the alluvial sequences are thin, maximum 15 meters or so. So here we have 30 meters, 40 meters thick of alluvial sequences. So only we are able to identify various formations which can also be associated with distinctive prehistoric cultures. So other sites, so the sites, type sites have also been examined for detailed chronology. As a result, the formation sequence that we have can be stratigraphically shown to have developed from Sihawal, Patpara, Sikuntheli, Patpara, then Bhagur, and then another site, forget name. So we have the site situated here in the open area. We have rock shelter sites, we have open air sites, and then we also have some cave sites in the limestone and so on. So rock shelter sites and open air sites are also now being investigated with more emphasis on identifying primary context, and so that we also not only have these finished tools, but also the waste products, so that we can understand the processing sequence, the way in which the workshops activity was conducted by the people who were making the local use of locally available raw material. Now, in the Son and Belen valleys, we have been able to identify the evolution of stone tool technology right from Lower Paleolithic to Middle Paleolithic to Upper Paleolithic and so on. Now, at a number of sites where we have investigated, we are fortunate enough that we have a dating control, we have a marker bed in the form of this youngest toba tuff, and so the sequence can be easily reconstructed. So we have this Patpara formation yielding as Upper Paleolithic, and that is comparable to the later Pleistocene context that we have in southern India and so on. And we also have microliths coming from this particular sequence here, comparable to the microliths known from already well-established sites like Patne in western Maharashtra. So OSL dating has also helped us understand that this is the late Acheulean, lower Paleolithic, last phase of development, survives till about 130,000 years or so. Later on, we tend to get distinctive change in the types of stone tools that we find in this. So this is typical Middle Paleolithic sites, artifacts that we have. And then the kind of basin model I was trying to explain in the beginning. So we have the densest occurrence of all these sites in Vindhyas, in Chhattisgarh, in Pranitha, Godavari, Kadapa, Kaladgi and Bhima basins and so on. So in the context of the results that we have obtained, multidisciplinary investigations that have been carried out in this two regions, Son Valley and this one, we have this marker horizon here, the Toba volcanic eruption. We have evidence coming from earliest times going to the lower Paleolithic associated with Homo erectus, and then there is a continuity. We have this evidence of post-Toba and pre-Toba Middle Paleolithic, and then Homo sapiens, microliths and so on and so forth, Mesolithic and Sear. So demographic expansion and contraction has also been identified based on the nature of evidence, intensity of occupation, and the quantification of artifacts coming from various contexts and so on. So we see that there is this particular time period where we see that possible replacement of archaic Homo sapiens taking place in India as a result of expansion of Homo sapiens belonging to this particular lineage, M and N, We are not very sure, but they are suggested on the basis of the work carried out by geneticists and so on. So the story is more or less same in both Middle Swan Valley as well as in southern Indian Jawaharlalpuram situation. Thank you very much.